Friends, I don't think I have any announcements to make today, except that Pastor Jim is sick. It is a virus. It's not COVID. He's got really bad vertigo, though, so he is not with us today. So we won't be doing communion. So when we do communion, it'll be a surprise. You'll just come, and that'll be what's up. Does anybody else have announcements they need to make? All right, well, let's join together in worship as we hear our prelude.
Join me in the call to worship. Let me hear in the morning of your steadfast love, for in you I trust.
Make me know the way I shall go, for in you I lift up my soul.
Week, I kind of gave you an introduction to what it was we were going to be doing for children's time. We're not going to be gathering up front, but we're going to make it kind of an intergenerational time for all of us, and we're calling it Holy Moments, where we just kind of talk about the different parts of what makes up a worship service. And there's going to be some, they're going to be really short, but it's going to walk us through just the different movements of worship in which we have opportunities to encounter God's love and God's presence when we are all gathered together. So there will be some little tiny things to do, activities to do, just kind of where you're at, and then I'll probably encourage you to have answer a question or two with the people sitting in your pew. So today we are talking about silence. But when we come for worship, it's often not silent, right? We hear the music, we hear the countdown, we hear chattering, we hear scripture being read, we hear the sermon being preached during worship. So there's a lot of noise that's involved in worship. But silence and quiet can be an important part of our worship as well. A lot of times, kids especially, but probably adults, when we think about silence and being quiet in church, we might think about it as having to be really still or not say anything while the sermon's being preached or while scripture is being read. But we talked last week, I read that kind of parent letter and church letter, how sometimes kids, we just have questions during the sermon, during the scripture, during the prayer time, and things just pop up. So it can be really hard for both kids and adults sometimes to be silent. Our world is really noisy. There's always something going on, music or television or video games or other people just chattering and talking that we often don't have an opportunity to enter in and be in a place of silence. And God speaks to us and reaches us in the quiet. So the practice of silence as a holy moment invites us to not just listen to what's going on in the room, but to listen and listen for God. So we're going to practice, just real quick, silence for just a few seconds. And then I am going to have you guys just kind of talk about that for a quick second. So if you want to get comfortable, and I'm going to do a countdown, 3, 2, 1, and then we're going to just sit silently for about 10 seconds. And then I'll do a 3, 2, 1 countdown again to kind of end that. So 3, 2, 1. So with someone sitting next to you and near you, talk about real quick why being silent is an important thing to practice once in a while. Dear parents and church, we have been learning and practicing silence as a worshipful, holy moment. Often when children think about silence or being quiet in church, they relate it to being asked to sit still and quiet while the sermon is preached or while scripture is being read. That is certainly an important way that silence is used in worship. It is difficult, however, for children and those adults around them to listen when there's a lot of noise. Practicing silence as a holy moment, rather than as a rule, invites us to listen not just to the dominant voice in the room, but to listen to God and to the world around us. So just a reminder that silence is not a rule, but it's an opportunity for a holy moment and a holy experience with God. Let us pray. Gracious and loving God, we just thank you so much for all of the ways that we can encounter you in worship. We thank you, God, for this reminder that being quiet is not something we have to do. It's not a rule that we have to follow when we're in church, but it's an opportunity for us to connect to you in a different way. Because our world is noisy, and sometimes we just need to be still and to be close to you and to draw close to you in the silence. And to be connected to you in your presence in the silence. In Jesus' name we pray, and all of God's children said, amen. And just a reminder for Isaac, for our Compassion International, there is a spot to drop those offerings out front there. It's marked Compassion International with Isaac on it, so we can continue to take our offerings for him to support him. Chapter 17, verses 9 through 16. Go now to Zarephath, which belongs in Sidon, and live there, for I have commanded a widow there to feed you. So he set out, and he went to Zarephath. When he came to the gate of the town, a widow was there gathering sticks. He called together and said, "Bring me a little water in a vessel so that I may drink." As she was going to bring it, he called to her and said, "Bring me a morsel of bread in your hand." But she said, "As the Lord your God lives, I have nothing baked, only a handful of meal in a jar and a little oil in a jug. I am now gathering a couple of sticks so that I may go home and prepare it for myself and my son, that we may eat it and die." Elijah said to her, "Do not be afraid. Go and do as you have said. But first, make me a little cake of it and bring it to me. And afterwards, make something for yourself and your son. For thus says the Lord, the God of Israel, the jar of meal will not be emptied, and the jug of oil will not fail until the day that the Lord sends rain on the earth." She went, and she did as Elijah said, so that she as well as he and her household ate for many days. The jar of meal was not emptied, neither did the jug of oil fail, according to the word of the Lord that he spoke by Elijah. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
You shall cross the barren desert, but you shall not die of thirst.
You shall wander far in safety, though you do not know the
shall speak your words to foreign lands, and all will understand.
You shall see the face of God and live. Be not afraid.
I know before you always
come, follow me, and I will give you rest.
Drown. If you walk amid the burning flame,
you shall not be harmed.
If you stand before the power of hell,
and death is at your side,
you will fall.
Fear is useless.
Do not be afraid.
You gotta be courageous.
Walk in faith.
Remain in hope, everyone.
Trust in the Lord.
God is with you.
Fear is not an option.
Pray without ceasing.
Don't lose hope, guys.
I trust you.
Be not afraid.
And I will give you
about my adventures on Thursday. That's another story, kind of like this one. Much longer, though. Anyway, thank you for your patience. We've been traveling through biblical history since September, and we're making good progress. Remember, our plan is to go through the whole biblical story from creation up until the time when Jesus and Paul launched the church, and we're going to do that basically in the school year. Not that that has a whole lot of meaning for us these days. We did it last year, the same kind of arc of history, and we're going to do that the next couple years. But the scriptures are going to be different each year, so don't think that if you come every day this year, you can just take the next two off, because you're going to want to hear all of this. Our focus today is Elijah. But I want to pause a minute on that and bring you up to speed on what has been happening. I don't know about you, but my church attendance has been spotty, and sometimes I go to worship with other churches and things like that. So, in case you haven't been here every single day, the Israeli people had been miraculously freed from Egypt, right? Remember that, Moses, the 10 plagues and the parting of the Red Sea, and they'd been miraculously freed, and then they wandered around the desert. Of course, they were led by God, but they were in that desert for 40 years, and they reached the Promised Land. They settled there, and they started figuring out how to live in community. 400 years of slavery had pretty much destroyed their sense of being a people, of being all, you know, a community, and how they were going to live together as freed people. Well, they had those 10 commandments. That's important. God's very first set of instructions to his people on how to live. And the commandments were just the basics. He gave a lot more instructions, but that's a story for another day. So the Hebrew people looked around. They were building community and building houses and starting to farm and things like that. And they looked around and saw that successful, strong nations around them all had kings. Now God wanted God's people to trust God. But the people wanted a king. So enter first King Saul and then King David and then King Solomon, right? We've heard those stories recently. But after Solomon, that kingdom started to disintegrate, just like God had warned. There were good kings and there were bad kings. Things flourished really well when there were good things, and they got pretty dismal when there were bad kings. There were also prophets during this time. There still are prophets among us, but prophets were important, and some of the kings listened to them. And they were people who were given a special sort of vision, a special sort of knowledge, a way of seeing things through God's eyes. They knew what it was that God wanted. And then they would say that to the people and particularly to the rulers. They weren't like palm readers and crystal gazers. They didn't foretell the future, except that they could say, you know, guys, we're not following God. And if we don't follow God, things are going to get bad. If we do follow God, things will get good. That was really their main way of saying what was going to happen in the future. They really understood, though, what faithfulness to God meant for the people of God. The prophet's role was to call the people to righteousness and to warn them what would happen if they didn't put God first. Sometimes people listened to them, sometimes they didn't. Some kings heeded their warnings, some kings completely ignored them. You might remember a couple weeks ago we talked about the prophet Nathan and that King David did listen to Nathan, which was a good move. However, during the prophet Elijah's time, we have a bad king. King Ahab, he just wasn't a good guy. The Bible says Ahab, son of Omri, did evil in the sight of the Lord more than all who were before him. That's pretty bad. He married Jezebel, which is where, you know, when we think of Jezebel, what do you think of? Somebody really bad. Well, this is the original Jezebel. Her main issues were she was power hungry, and she worshipped Baal. Baal was believed to be the thunder god, small g, right? The thunder god, who's in charge of storms and in charge of rain and that sort of thing. And Ahab decided to follow her lead, and he became a Baal worshiper also. He put up monuments to Baal. He built places of worship to Baal. He was all about Baal. He even sacrificed his children, his youngest and his oldest, to build a city because Baal required human sacrifice. So, Ahab, bad guy. God, speaking through the prophet Elijah, announces that there's going to be a drought. You can see this is a direct slam on Baal, because if Baal's the thunder god and in charge of rain, and God says, there won't be any rain, God is showing that God is in control of the rain and of the thunder, not this pretend Baal dude. Well, King Ahab did not want to hear that. So God is taking care of Elijah, and he says, Elijah, go to the Wadi Cherith. You'll find water there. God has ravens come and feed Elijah. God is showing that it is God, with a capital G, who's in charge. And Elijah, to his credit, obeys. He goes to that wadi, which is, it's a ravine, basically. It's water flows through there when there's rain up in the mountains, and then it dries up. So it's not like a river. The water there is intermittent. But he stays there, and he waits. He waits to see what it is that God is going to do next. God is still taking care of Elijah. And I think that it may have been Elijah's faithfulness that allowed him to hear God's next instructions. Sometimes being faithful means waiting for God's timing. So that's where today's scripture picks up. This wadi dries up. And God says to Elijah, let's go to Sidon. I want you to go to Sidon, to a town called Zarephath. And God tells Elijah that a widow there will provide for him. Now that's interesting, because in that culture, widows had no way of making money. Well, there wasn't really money, but they had no way of earning food. They lived hand to mouth at best. If they were fortunate, a family member would take them in. But there was nowhere for this single mom to go and get a job. They just didn't exist. Normally, this man of God, Elijah, would provide for the powerless. But things are turned upside down, and Elijah is to go get help from a person normally considered a charity case. Sometimes help comes to us from the least expected quarters. And that's what was happening for Elijah. It's also interesting to me that Zarephath is in the country controlled by Baal worshippers. So God not only says go to this widow, who probably can't help you, but go back into this Baal territory. Why would he want to head back into trouble? Isn't there a widow someplace else that could feed him? That's what I'd be thinking. Could we go someplace a little more friendly, Lord? But Elijah's faithful, and he goes. The town name Zarephath translates to smelt, refine, purify. So it's likely that there were the Iron Age equivalent of a refinery then in that place. But Elijah's told to go to this place, and we can assume that it is for him to be refined. So sure enough, Elijah shows up at Zarephath, and sure enough, there's a widow collecting sticks. He asks her for a drink of water, and she's happy to provide that. But he also asks for a bite to eat. She tells him that she has no bread, and in fact, there's only a little bit of oil and a little bit of ground meal. She's gathering sticks to make a fire to cook one last loaf for her and her son, and then they will starve. Elijah tells her, don't be afraid. Easy for you to say. Go ahead and give him some water and make him a biscuit. And then she can make some for herself and her kid. Because, he tells her, the Lord God has said that your jar of meal will not be emptied, nor will your jug of oil until the Lord sends rain. And that woman goes and does what he says. I thought, what a remarkable act of faith, right? She doesn't even believe in the God that Elijah's talking about. She's a Baal worshiper. And Elijah's there saying, yeah, give me the rest of your food. It'll be fine. My God will take care of you. But she goes and she does what he says. And sure enough, her oil and her meal do not run out. They do not run out until the rains come. Now, giving the stranger some water is not a big deal. I'd probably give a stranger who asked me for some water some water. I'd probably make that happen. But he goes on to ask for some food. Now, for me, that isn't a big deal. I have food. But for this woman, living in a time of drought, the crops weren't going, the trees weren't bearing, giving away her food was a big deal. Widows didn't have it easy in that time. They could glean in the fields after the harvest. That was part of the community, was you left some food on the stalks there. They could beg. They could maybe find a family member. But in this scenario, this widow, this woman, had no resources. She was going to prepare one last meal, share it with her son, and then accept the inevitability of death. But she made the decision to share what she had. The stranger told her it was okay, but come on, who believes a stranger? Especially a hungry one. Of course he's going to say that, right? Cynical me. And this one says that this God that isn't the little G God that she believes in will take care of her. But part of God's plan in all of this is to show the widow that she can trust God. She can trust our God. She doesn't have to chase after some man-made idol, but she can know the provision and the care of the real God. And I wonder if there are times in our lives where our need can actually be a source of blessing for other people. So she shared, and amazingly, every time she went to her jar and to her jug, there was enough for the next meal. And that lasted until there were other food sources available for her. I don't know about the rest of you, but I feel like I'm in a drought. I'm in a drought of friendship. I can't remember the last time that I just hung out with a friend. A drought of church stuff. The things that, you know, make us a community. There's no Bible study. We can't even really chat after services. We can't help in the kitchen for the grow people. A drought of family. Some of you, I think, know that we're having a grandchild due December 6th. Super exciting, right? But we're not throwing a baby shower. We're not seeing our loved ones. We're not playing those dumb shower games that you have to play at those. I don't know why. But instead, I'm making meals for her freezer because I can't go when that baby's born. I can't go to the hospital and see them. Oh, my gosh. I haven't been able to take my daughter shopping to get, you know, those cute little outfits. Can't do that. Her doctor is telling her that she has to start isolating at 37 weeks, stay home until, of course, she's in labor. So we can't even see her now or right after the baby's born. It's a drought. It's a drought for me. And I know that all of you have similar drought stories. We're all making sacrifices. This is a hard time. And compounding that, there's the election. I can hardly watch the news. My anxiety goes, woo! If you haven't voted already, vote, okay? That's what we're going to say about the election. But I wonder how things are going to play out. I'm concerned about the acrimony and the division, even over, you know, are we going to accept results and things like that. And there's people freaking out when they're asked to wear a mask by, you know, employees who aren't even making the decisions. These are hard times. And God's there. God is with us. God is so with us every step of this way. So what's God asking of us during this hard time? A lot, I think. First of all, to wait until God's timing is perfect. You know, Elijah had to sit at that wadi in that ravine that was drying up and wait. Today does not seem perfect. The rest of the state's in restrictions. We may be soon. Jim and I were planning to leave today after worship to go see his mom. It's been almost a year. She's in her 90s. we need to see my mother-in-law. We really want to. But Jim's down with this virus. It hurts him to move. He gets nauseated and dizzy if he moves at all. So we're postponing our trip and hoping that he recovers quickly. And we're looking at the COVID numbers going off. And we do not want to be the people to accidentally take COVID into this big retirement village of thousands of people. You know, so all we can do is hope, right? We're waiting. It's dry. There's drought here. And we're hoping that he gets well quickly, that the increase in infection, COVID infections, doesn't prevent our visit. So we're doing our best to wait in faith, even when that doesn't feel like a good idea. A second thing is to allow our faith to show so that others can be blessed. Even in these hard times, to speak up about what God has done and what God is doing. Elijah was bold enough to tell this stranger that her needs would be met by God. In our time of waiting, in our time of drought, are we bold enough to speak that? I want to be. I sure want to be. A third thing, God wants our trust and our faith. Knowing that God is still on the throne regardless of the election's outcome. Keeping our hearts soft toward those with whom we disagree. Being bridge builders, not bridge burners. Elijah had to ask someone with a totally different belief system for help, and she gave that help. They didn't sit and argue about what they believed. They responded as one human to another. May we all have that grace. And finally, number four, God wants everything that we have. God wanted that last bit of oil and that last bit of meal. So God wants everything. God wants the things that we rely on instead of relying on God. Are the last bit of whatever it is that we're counting on that isn't God. God wants us to rely on God and God only, not the things that our culture tells us about. God may even want us to do things that don't even make sense. But I'll leave you with this thought. What can you offer to God today? What are things that you can let go of so that God can show his provision and love? Challenging times, friends, but I know you're up for it. And I know that you're up for it not because of you, but because of God. And I know that you're up for it because of your faith in God. And my prayer for every single person here is that we continue to act in faith and to act in love so that God's glory can be shown. Amen. Friends, I'm going to invite you today to stay through the postlude. We were richly blessed last week, and I would invite you to just spend that time maybe thinking or praying and enjoying the postlude. And let me offer a benediction. May the face of God turn upon you and shine upon you. May you have faith and courage to go forth in these times. In the name of God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. Amen.